Good afternoon. It's a pleasure to be with you, even more of a pleasure when I don't have to be the speaker. So I can truly enjoy what you are about to be privileged to hear, two quite wonderful people. And I know that you know quite a lot about Karen Armstrong. Many of you would not be here if you didn't know that. This crowded house speaks well, Karen, for people's looking forward to what it is you have to say to us. Many of them, I'm sure, without asking, have read one, two, perhaps all of Karen's books. And you know her through those books. But I want to say just a little bit about Karen, and I know her and would call her one of my treasured friends. I've known her for quite a long time. But when I came to know her best was the summer of 2002. And if you think back to 2002, you may imagine what I'm going to tell you before I say it. I was working then at the Chautauqua Institution as the director of religion. And the summer before, we had made what we felt was a very important decision. Chautauqua had been, in the main, a place for Christians to dialogue and to meet with one another. It seemed to us that it was time that we think along the Abrahamic lines. We've gone further than that by now, but at that point we came to when we say we must understand our Abrahamic neighbors. And so we began that summer. It was to be our very first summer to do this, and we had made a decision. This was in 2001, that we would, in fact, begin with Islam, since we felt we knew the least about Islam, that it was most important for us that we learn to be neighbors. And so we chose to make that move. If you have your calendars in your mind, you will know very well that having made that decision in 2001, we were then faced with the reality of it being 2002, and 9/11 had happened. We had a long, and I would say somewhat tortured discussion, to be perfectly honest, about are we really ready to have a dialogue on the Abrahamic religions and begin with this time right after 9/11. We talked, and we talked about it, and we talked some more. And we never could talk ourselves out of it. We felt it would be totally wrong to talk ourselves out of making the move that we had already agreed to make, to admit that this was the religion we knew the least about. And so we reached out and said, if we're going to do this, we need to have somebody with us all 9 weeks. And we need for somebody that will be able to wrestle with the issues that we know will be before us. That person was none other than Karen Armstrong. If Karen and I were ever to be friends, it had to be that summer. And if friendship was ever tested, it would become so in that particular summer. The fact of the matter is, as we talked about issues of justice and war and beauty and pluralism and peace, these were the topics 1 week after another. The very first one was called beauty. Neither Karen nor I will ever forget, I believe, what happened as we opened up for the very first week of a 9-week season and declared that we were going to be talking about beauty. We had no more than announced it, and I had announced that Karen was going to be here with us, and she was going to be the person who kind of held it together throughout each of these weeks, when a woman stood up in the audience. Where's Karen? I'm looking for her. She will remember very well. This woman stood up and she said, "Beauty? How dare you talk about it?" Karen hadn't even appeared yet, nor had our speaker. Our poor speaker is sitting next to me, not moved, I must say. He didn't. I said, are you all right? He said, I'm fine. She had quite a major diatribe, I might say. That's probably the kind way of putting how we began that first week, as we began to reach out and deal with the issue of Islam. I personally, and I believe Karen would agree with me, we are grateful, beyond grateful that we did it. Very grateful that Chautauqua had the courage to do this, and it became a mark for all of us. But for Karen and for me, we became fast friends. And Karen, I don't think anything could break up that friendship. If anything could have, it would have been that summer. And so, before I bring her up here, I'll give you a light touch. One of the weeks, I can't remember which it was, it wouldn't matter, I believe it was the week on pluralism. We had had a speaker, an Islamic speaker on pluralism, and this woman who was sitting very much in the front row was very agitated, obviously, and she stood up and she put out the most brutal question. I don't even want to repeat the question. You can only just use your imagination. Why are we doing this? What kind of place is Chautauqua? What is this all about? And she went on like this. And then, when I turned to Karen to answer it, she walked out of where we were gathered. And I said to her in a very motherly way, Madam, get yourself back here. You cannot ask questions like that and walk away. And then I heard a voice on the porch, not very far away, where a young man was sitting there, and he said, oh my God, she's my mother. If I were that lady, I'd get over there in a hurry. And she did. And she did finally speak to the question. But only to make it, this is Karen's life, only to make it a little more challenging, Karen was invited to be the guest speaker on a lovely, it was a cruise ship, I believe. Very small, very special, only very special people invited to be on it, and she was to speak about Islam. All right, you know. Who was on the trip? This particular lady who asked the question at Chautauqua. And Karen reported to me that she had changed dramatically. She had taken seriously the challenges and what she'd heard, and in a way, it was an affirmation of our decision that summer to ask Karen Armstrong to be with us as Chautauqua dealt right after 9/11 with the issue of Islam. Karen Armstrong, be my guest.
Thank you, Joan. That really was a memorable summer. There were, I think, 2 days when I didn't want to leave my room. Things were so bad. But it was important, and we struggled through to the end, and it was a valuable thing to do. And yet, I'm standing before you at another awful time. There's been more Islamophobia now in the United States since 9/11, this last year. And you may notice I am struggling with a very bad cough, and I've just had some stuff given to me for it, but Tori noticed that the cough started just about the time when Donald Trump was landing at the airport. But it's really great to be here in Louisville. I've enjoyed my visits here before. But this time coming back, it's very special because Louisville has become absolutely central to our project for building a network of compassionate cities. Louisville has become one of the best of our cities, determined somehow to implement, to insert the difficult virtue of compassion into the gritty reality of urban life in the 21st century. And it's absolutely crucial. That this is done. Because if compassion remains simply an airy notion, sort of kumbaya, a soft option where people are just nice to one another in their private lives, and somehow do not make it work politically or socially, I really feel we have very little hope of handing the next generation with a viable world. Because I've come to the conclusion that compassion is not just a nice idea, it's now an urgent global imperative. I came to this with difficulty. I had not experienced religion, for example, as a compassionate enterprise, to put it mildly. But I wrote a book called The Great Transformation when all our great world religious traditions came into being at about the same time in India, in the Middle East, and in Greece, in Europe. And every single one of them, in their own way, quite independently, came to the conclusion that the bedrock of spirituality and ethics was what we now call the Golden Rule. Never treat others as you would not like to be treated yourself. And insisted that this, and not a particular belief or a doctrine or a political position, this was at the heart of all our religious traditions. It was the test of true spirituality. And yet, I was getting frustrated because you heard so little about it. Very often when religious leaders come together, we're often here to condemn something, like condemn homosexuality, for example, or coming to profess a particular doctrine. But you didn't hear about this one thing that the world needs at the moment. Because unless now we learn to implement the Golden Rule globally, and it begins in cities, I think, the world is simply not going to be viable, for it, because we are we've not done it in the past, and we're now beginning to reap some of the rewards of this. The Golden Rule requires you to look into your own heart, discover what gives you pain, and then refuse under any circumstance whatsoever to inflict that pain on anybody else. Never treat others as you would not like to be treated yourself. One of the first people to propose the Golden Rule in a way that was written down was Confucius in the 5th century BCE. And he said, you do this all day and every day. Not just when you feel like it. It has to become an absolute habitual practice. In England, we have a habit when we've done something nice for somebody, we often say, well, that's my good deed for the day, as though we could then return to the next 23 hours to our usual habits of greed and unkindness and bitterness. No, all day and every day. And it requires you to transcend the self. That is why it's so important in spirituality. They all insisted too, that you could not confine this benevolence to your own particular group. You had to have what another Chinese sage called yan ai, concern for everybody. You have this in the monotheistic traditions too. Love the stranger, the foreigner, says Leviticus. If a foreigner lives with you in your land, do not molest him. You must treat him as one of your own people and love him as yourself, for you were strangers in Egypt. And here you have the logic of the Golden Rule. Remember the times when you were a despised, oppressed, marginalized minority in a foreign land in Egypt, and make sure that nobody in your vicinity, in your own country, has to suffer such pain. In your society. And the word love, I think, needs decoding here, because one of the problems we're having with compassion is that it's got kind of soft and mushy, a bit full of kumbaya, and that this toughness tends to be dissipated. Love, for example, in English has got really debased. You know, I love ice cream. Didn't you love that movie? Or else it suggests a sort of great welling of emotion. But in the ancient Near East, the time Leviticus was written, love, hesed in Hebrew, was a political term, a political legal term used in treaties, international treaties. Two kings who may have been enemies previously would promise to love each other. And that didn't mean that they would fall into one another's arms and become best friends, best buddies. Love meant loyalty. It meant that they would look out for one another's best interests, even if this went against their own short-term goals. That they would come to their aid, new ally, when he was in trouble. And they would do all they could to give him practical help and support. Now, this is the kind of love we need to give our so-called enemies today, if we want a peaceful world. And Jesus said, love your enemies, here. And the fate of Jesus reminds us that compassion can be dangerous. Here's a man who, in the Gospel of Mark, at the end of chapter 1 of this earliest of the Gospels, is so besieged by suffering, desperate people that he can't leave the city. We sometimes read the gospel piecemeal in church. We don't get the full effect of this. Jesus is claustrophobically surrounded by suffering people at the end of their tether. They're sick, they're blind, they're deaf, and many of them are deranged, demented, filled with, they said, devils. And the gospel says that they are struck down with... The Greek words used mean that he looked at them and he saw that they were hard-pressed, and the Greek words used means with imperial predation. Jesus was a political figure, and he was killed by the Roman authorities for asking for a fairer, more compassionate world. And other people we've seen in our own, the 20th century, Dr. King, Gandhi, who preached the compassionate ethic very effectively, but paid the ultimate price. So in becoming a compassionate city, one's taking on a great risk and a great challenge. And it won't always be easy. It's not about being nice. I personally am not filled with peace and love and joy. If I'm filled with anything, it's a kind of dread. I never intended to get into all this business about talking about religion or writing about Islam. My goal was to be a university professor teaching English literature, and it didn't happen. But a turning point for me was during the Salman Rushdie crisis. There, if you remember, the Ayatollah Khomeini, on his deathbed, his government had issued a fatwa saying that the Salman Rushdie and his supporters and his publishers could be killed. This was outrageous, went against major Islamic and indeed Iranian Shiite ideology. And of course, I was dead against that. But I was also utterly horrified by the way the liberal intellectuals of Britain, and these were not just little unknown people, they were major novelists, philosophers, intellectuals, and journalists, segued from an out-and-out denunciation of the fatwa to a denunciation of Islam as an essentially evil and bloodthirsty religion. And I remember sitting surrounded by the Sunday papers and thinking that this reminded me of the 1930s and 1940s. It was this kind of rhetoric used by Hitler that had made the concentration camps possible, by dehumanizing. And at the end of that decade, at the end of the 90s, there were concentration camps again around the periphery of Europe, this time with Muslims in them, in Bosnia. So there's that kind of dread and urgency I have. So, as I say, it's hard work, and we have somehow to find a way to grapple with the political realities of our time and make compassion, to feel with the other, to treat others, all others, as we would wish to be treated ourselves, a real reality. If we British had behaved with more respect to the people in our colonies during the 18th, 19th, and 20th centuries, we would not be having so many political problems today. Things are coming back to haunt us. Now, the people who founded the Golden Rule, started it up, were all living not in peaceful, idyllic groves. Like Jesus, they were living in times where violence and injustice and suffering had reached an unbearable crescendo. China, for example, at the time of Confucius, was just embarking on a terrible period of Chinese history. It's often called the Warring States period, because for over 200 years, all the states, small states on the big great plain of China, fought one another with desperate, terrible casualties for over 200 years, most of the casualties among the peasantry, until there was only one state left. The others were all destroyed, and that became the Chinese Empire. And Confucius, his golden rule was not just a private imperative, though it was that too. His whole life was spent tramping from one court to another, trying to make the rulers of China observe the golden rule. Because he said, if we don't behave to each other as we would wish to be others to behave to us, we will destroy one another. And that has never been more true than it is today. A little while ago, I think it was 2 or 3 years ago, I did a video link up. I think perhaps it was with this festival in Louisville. And I was in London at home and was speaking to an audience somewhere. And somebody asked me, what should a compassionate city look like? What should it be like? And I said, a compassionate city should be an uncomfortable city. Why? Because, and here, I'm sure I'll be corrected if I'm wrong, but I believe the Prophet Muhammad once, peace be upon him, once said, not one of you can be a believer if he can sleep when he knows that someone is hungry. And we know, because we are inundated with images of suffering and pain more than any previous generation. We know that not only are people hungry, they are on flimsy boats, little rafts, literally dying to get into Europe. They are enduring on a daily basis what the Europeans endured for one or two, 3 days last year. There's hunger, and there's disease and massive inequity. And sometimes, you know, when we look at these, we get, someone called it once, compassion fatigue. We think, oh, I can't deal with this. I don't want to see it. But we should see it as a spiritual opportunity. We should perhaps fix on one of those images, perhaps a child one I'm thinking of was literally dying in its mother's arms in a refugee camp in Europe, and call it during the day, and let it trouble us, because that trouble, that discomfort that we feel when we are living lives of such utter privilege here, that is like the grain of sand in the oyster that creates the pearl. And it's that discomfort that creates true compassion, to allow ourselves to realize, not to be miserable all the time, that's not the point, but that won't help anybody, but to say what could we practically do to assuage this? It's about pain. Look into your own heart, discover what gives you pain, and then refuse under any circumstances that not to do this to anybody else. Now, we are living in an interconnected world. We're linked together, our economies are so interdependent that when markets fall in one part of the world, stocks plummet all around the globe that day. We all face the same environmental possibility of disaster. We're linked together electronically in a way that would once have been conceivable on the World Wide Web. People can look into their phones now and see the way we live. No wonder they want to come to our privileged world. And yet, the more global we become, the more tribal people want to feel. We've got this ludicrous thing going on, a terribly dangerous thing going on in Britain at the moment. Should Britain leave the European Union? And people are saying absurd things like, oh, we must be proud again. Rubbish. Rubbish. We need Europe. 100 years ago, Europeans were killing one another in these disastrous wars. The fact that we're sitting round table, however ineptly, tackling day-to-day problems is a triumph. Scotland tried to leave the European Union. And the United Kingdom, to go it alone. Fortunately, that did not work out, that wish. Similarly, in the religious world, the more global our vision comes with interfaith, the more some people want to retreat to denominational ghettos. That's why you have fundamentalism, where people feel threatened by this likeness. And want to hold on to this nugget of individuality. But this is not a rational assessment. I think the Dalai Lama has said this. This is not a rational assessment of our current situation, which is interdependence. So the suffering we're seeing in other parts of the world has already redounded on us. And this is in no way condoning these terrorist acts. But this has come from decades of neglect and selfishness and pursuit of the wrong kind of policies, not supporting rulers in or regimes in various countries of the world that would give their people none of the liberties that we enjoy. We're not doing it. That's not the golden rule. Don't impose on others, said Confucius, what you yourself do not desire. Now, we had some bad days in Europe. I mentioned them. And it was. This is heartbreaking. One of the things that's happening, you see, is that we are now in the privileged West are beginning to endure some of the privations that people in these other countries that we've been helping to keep in this bad state have felt all along. There are certain places now where it's not really safe for us to go on holiday. our world is beginning to shrink. When we go through the airport, we have all this palaver with, you know, taking our shoes off and looking out, and we all get frightened when something like Egypt Air happens. Is it another terrorist attack? But this is only a pinprick of the fear and lack of freedom that people have around the world, which is these migrants. Now, the Charlie Hebdo massacre in January was a real, it was an atrocious crime. An atrocious crime. But you know, when I saw those European and world leaders linking arms and marching together for freedom and liberté and freedom of expression, I felt quite sick. Because many of them, including my own prime minister, had, as I say, for decades supported regimes like Saudi Arabia in Muslim-majority countries, which allow their people no freedom of expression at all. And this is not, and we only seem to mourn our own people. A few weeks before that Paris catastrophe, 145 Pakistani children had been shot dead by the Taliban. Just a day or two after, 2,000 villagers, men, women, children, and the elderly, had been slaughtered by Boko Haram. Tiny mentions in the press compared with the Paris bonanza. And this is noticed in the Muslim world. The other day, Tori gave us that magnificent talk where she showed the number of people who've died. 90% of the people who have died in Afghanistan and Iraq in the wars were civilians who were simply in the wrong place at the wrong time. And yet, we never really mentioned them. We quite rightly mourn our dead servicemen who come back from these terrible places and have paid the ultimate price. But we must also remember these others too. Otherwise, it looks as though we think that some lives are more valuable than others. And you know, this is not unnoticed. Just shortly after that Paris catastrophe, I visited Jordan, and I was giving a talk to a small group. It was a closed group, no cameras or anything, who were members of the royal family, diplomats, statesmen, members of the diplomatic community. And one of them, and these were not a bunch of hotheads, one of them was the prime minister, was the foreign minister who had brokered the peace treaty with Israel. And he said, you know, the West has lost its humanity. You don't care about our dead. The fact that one of the princesses got up and said, we are also terrorized by these people. Far more Muslims have died at the hands of extremists than Western people. And as I said earlier, that day in Paris was just a pinprick to what these people have been enduring in Syria. Paris would have been an almost daily occurrence. After the last attack, Paris attack in November, 2 days earlier, 44 people in Beirut had been killed by two IS suicide bombers. And they were never mentioned. As soon as we died, then up went the tricolor, the French flag on every building. Why not the Lebanese flag too? And the Lebanese noticed it. They said that none of this matters, that we don't matter. This is not a good feeling to spread around the world. We're not seeing that compassion, that fellow feeling. Your pain is my pain. I want to end with a story. Amin has heard it before. I often finish my speeches with it. I haven't done it for some time because I I've been concerned with other things like Paris and such. But this is really speaking to us now. It's from Homer's Iliad. It's as you know, the Iliad tells the story of a small incident in the long 20-year war between the Greeks and the Trojans. And in the course of this terrible warfare, Agamemnon, the king, has a quarrel with his leading warrior, Achilles. And Achilles, in a fit of egotistic pique, marches off to his tent and sulks. And more importantly, he withdraws all his men from the battlefield, from the battle. This is disastrous, absolutely disastrous for the Greek side. Achilles is their star. Nobody can beat him. And in the course of this horror, this mess that's occurred, Achilles' beloved friend Patroclus is killed in a skirmish by Hector, one of the princes of Troy. And Achilles goes mad with guilt, grief, and rage. And he challenges Hector to a duel. The two of them will slug it out. And they do so, the royal family, Hector's family, watch from the Trojan walls. And they look, nobody can beat Achilles, though. And he kills Hector. And then he mutilates the body. He, determined to take revenge, he ties Hector's body onto his war chariot and rides it, drags it round and round and round Patroclus's grave. And then he does a terrible thing. He refuses to give the body back to the family for burial. And in Greek terms, that meant that Hector's soul would never know rest, but it would be restless and distressed for all eternity. But then one night, Hector's father, old King Priam of Troy, comes in disguise into the enemy camp. Great danger, great risk. And he finds his way to Achilles' tent. And then he throws off his disguise. And of course, everybody is utterly shocked. Here is the king, the chief enemy in enemy territory. And the old man approaches Achilles. Achilles, who has killed not just Hector, but many others of his sons. And he falls at Achilles. The old man falls at Achilles' feet. Hugs, embraces his knees, and weeps. And Achilles looks at the old man, and he remembers his father, and he begins to weep. And Homer says the two men wept together, Priam for Hector and for all the sons that, as he called him at this point, man-slaughtering Achilles, had slain, and Achilles, now for Patroclus, now for his father. And then they stop weeping. The Greeks believed that weeping together created a bond between men because it showed the pain that lies at the heart of all our experience, all of us, whatever side we're on. And Achilles, the two men look at these great arch enemies, look into each other's eyes. And Homer tells us that each saw the other as divine, as a god. And then Hector goes. I mean, Achilles goes and he brings Hector's body and lays it very tenderly in the father's arms, Priam's arms, because the weight might be too much for him to bear. And that, I think, should be an emblem of our time. Two wounded men, arch enemies, both of whom have damaged each other irreparably, and they're two peoples that have damaged each other irreparably. But this they have felt that bond of compassion that unites them. And it is that which makes us truly godlike, truly divine, when we recognize that our so-called enemies also have pain. Thank you.
Please know that you will have, after our next speaker, we will have an opportunity for you to ask questions directly. So I don't want you to think that we're passing up that opportunity, but I think it's important that we hear the next speaker, because then you will be able to look at this whole issue through two sets of eyes, always, I'm told, helpful. Amin Hashwani has been a part of the Charter of Compassion and a part of our efforts for quite a long time, perhaps, I believe, from the very beginning. And he has come today and we're very pleased that he's here with us to offer some of his thinking as well on the Charter and how it has come alive in the country of Pakistan. So let me give you just a few words about what they've been doing, and I think that sets the stage for Amin to tell us the story of what's happening with the Charter in Pakistan. For years, the people of Karachi, and this is written now from the people of Karachi, for years the people of Karachi have suffered from both pervasive violence and the stress that comes with living in it, into what is called a very violent environment. Some people in that situation have understandably become focused more on self-preservation than on helping others. Sensing a deep yearning for a different way of living, the Pakistanis launched a Compassionate Karachi, and the Five Vision campaign came alive. In only a few months' time, 400,000 submissions came in from citizens representing 400 schools, 28 universities, and 100 other organizations. Soon after, leaders, including those from a variety of faith traditions, unveiled a charter with these five principles. And these are the five principles that they offer. All children should receive a quality education regardless of background of financial means. Number two, all people should have access to standard medical facilities at affordable rates. I'm expecting some applause here. Number three, all people should have clean food and water, sanitation and shelter. They ring just not for that time and place, but for ours as well. Number four, all laws should be respected and applied equally without regard to social, economic, or political status. And number five, all people should be able to walk Karachi's streets without fear or concern for their safety. If you knew Amin as I do, you would not be surprised that with his leadership and what he has done to bring the Charter, not only to bring it alive, but to give it wisdom and purpose within that country. And so we are fortunate today to have Amin with us to do some reflecting on what it means when people take the Charter of Compassion, not simply as words put forward, but as actions come alive. Amin, please come to the mic.
Good afternoon, and salam alaikum, everyone. I'm coming from Karachi to Kentucky. It took me about 30 hours getting here. And believe me, I'm still not jet lagged. And the reason for that is the incredible and the spontaneous hospitality that I've gotten over here. And a big, big thank you from the bottom of my heart for the organizers and all of you. Thank you very much. Karen, she spoke about the need for compassion in our society. I think we are all aware of the challenges which we are facing today as a global humanity on multiple fronts, be it global warming, deforestation, species extinction, ocean rising, epidemics, human displacements, conflicts, water stress, food shortages, glaciers, refugees, El Nino, non-communicable diseases, and the list goes on. A lot of these problems have been around since a long time. The issue today is that the scales have increased so much that there is a sense of urgency because a lot of these issues are coming to the tipping point where they will soon become irreversible. This is not like the 14th century plague where a quarter of a continent's population died and we were scratching our heads for a cure. Today we have the technology, the resources, and the solutions to find and cure and solve them without exception. And yet we are failing miserably. And there's one simple answer, that we have failed to evolve as a compassionate society globally. It's that simple. Each and every problem we can think about and you can dissect it, and at the root of it is that we are not being a compassionate society, be it as a nation, as a community, as a global society. Yes, we've had successes, but those successes have been only when the situation has reached a crisis level, like the Paris Agreement, which we had on global warming. It should have happened long, long time ago. Or efforts of certain individuals like Bill Gates or Warren Buffett that have put a dent on some of these issues. Or the solutions have simply become overwhelmingly easy because our resources have expanded, our technology has like increased. So finding solution is not that big a deal and it can be done. So we pat ourselves on the back for it. The scales have increased of these problems so much that no nation state, however big it is, cannot solve them in isolation. We need collaborative solutions. We like to think ourselves to be as global citizens. Just because I can buy something on Amazon, I can read online, and the news does not make me a global citizen. We look at our phone book, we look at our Facebook, you look at all our activities which you do, we are very much localized. It's within our community, within a specific vicinity of our jobs, schools, etc. So we really are not globalized citizens. Just because commerce has become global or news has become, information has become global, does not make us global citizens. We're not global. We're still very tribal in our ways. The reptilian side of our brain still dominates us. Globalization is it's a very destabilizing experience. The changes and the uncertainty that brings with it, it breeds fear and insecurity. The world is becoming flat for just a few of us, not for everyone. While income disparities between nations is decreasing, but within nations, the gap is increasing between the haves and the haves not. Information age is actually a double-edged sword. It informs us, no doubt, but how much it enlightens us, I'm not sure. If anything, it reinforces our biasness. We see what we see. we are becoming more judgmental because we can selectively seek information that reinforces our beliefs. When was the last time anyone went on this talk show, saw one of these TV debates, and the person saying, gee, I never thought of that, you know, that's a great point and I'm going to change my point. No, we're just there to just reinforce. And as Karen says, that we'd rather be right than be compassionate. And I think collectively I see that we are witnessing this willful and collective blindness on a global scale. These issues that are hovering just around the corner, we somehow are in our concrete jungles, in our comfort zones, and it's just not touching. I mean, these are emergencies on multiple fronts, and yet we are increasing our defense spendings, and we still, you know, so polarized communities. And this you see in US elections, you see in the Middle East conflicts, you see in India, you see in Pakistan, Turkey, Egypt, Israel, you name it, and it is there. We're becoming more and more polarized. And as Karen once said, there's no clash of civilization, but there's clash within civilizations that is taking place. And if anything, and if there's any clash, it's the clash of ignorance. And it's a great irony that in the so-called information age, our ignorance level is actually increased. The civil society movement, be it the Arab Spring, the Occupy Wall Street, the Anna Hazare movement in this India, the call for Sharia, these are all cries for justice, and which are faltering. All of these movements have really faltered. And hence we have this new breed of quick fix leaders. And trust me, Donald Trump is not the only leader. You look at all over the world, you look at the rightist leaders all over Europe that are propping up with these quick fix solutions. One example is Philippines, Rodrigo. I don't know if some of you might have heard him. He's the presidential, he's running for the presidential race. Excuse me, my crudeness, but he's someone who runs death squads as the mayor. And his promise is that when I become the president, I'll be killing 100,000 criminals when I become the president. So that's his claim for fame. Apart from running, being on as an entertainer on a TV show, womanizing in his 70s, and calling the Pope a son of a bitch. All right, this is on national TV. Not to mention, there was a prison riot in his constituency where a nun from Australia was raped and killed. And his comment at a rally was that, first I felt sad, but then I looked at a picture and she was really pretty. And I felt that me as a mayor should have had the first go at it. And guess what? This gentleman, and by the way, in the next interview, he said, I was not joking. I mean, he clarified. And this gentleman got elected as the president of Philippines. Okay? So, you know, we can take these things very lightly, but there is something seriously going on, and I think we need to wake up and smell the coffee. We are all multidimensional human beings, but somehow we have compartmentalized ourselves into nationalism, capitalism, tribalism, ethnicities, religiosities. While some of these bind us as communities, but it also blinds us. And I think we are becoming more and more blind to each other. And we're losing out on our collective humanity, as Karen very aptly put it. Nation-state structures are industrial age constructs that have become outdated. We need to evolve as a globalized community, and our identities have to be transnational. We do not have a choice, trust me. If we keep on thumping our chest as under nationalistic banners, we are not going very far, trust me. I'm here as a business person. I'm a capitalist by profession and a socialist by heart. The reason why, you know, I really thought about it, why should we businessmen should step up? I've been in a lot of track to diplomacies between countries. I've seen, be it the Israelis or the in the Middle East, the Arabs, the Indians and the Pakistanis, diplomats, heads of states, etc. And there's so much baggage which governments, militaries, diplomats have to, they have to stick to certain taglines. We businessmen, we do not have any of that baggage. We have the luxury to speak our minds out. What is our job description? We are problem solvers. That's what we do. Day in, day out, we go into our businesses and we solve problems. We are civil society leaders. We are respected within our societies. We are credible. We bring entrepreneurial skills to the table. We can take risks and we can think out of the box. And we can actually embrace failure. In the social sector especially, it's very, very risk averse, as some of you would know who work in the social sector. We love to fail and we love to learn from it. As Plato had said, those who are not, who are too smart to engage in politics are punished by being governed by those who are dumber. Now, I'm not advocating that every business person should become, join politics, but we need to step up to this game. We are civil society leaders, and you know what, like I said, this, the nation state structures are diluting, and our so-called political leaders, even their powers are diluting. The only problem is if we step up, the civil society needs to step up and really take a very proactive approach in this thing. Let me, before I talk about the charter in Pakistan, I want to give a feel of how people see in Pakistan, what the context is over there. It's very different, and I would like to just say a few things. They say whatever you read about Pakistan is true, but then the opposite is also true. I'll just go over with a few slides, and I want to give a... This was during Zia-ul Huq's time. Karen, you can see it in that thing. The Islamization came in. This was the unholy alliance between the US and the Pakistan military. Things like jihad is a violent thing we had never heard of. The only thing we knew, heard was Jihadul Akbar. That was the struggle to make yourself as an individual. This jihad is a violent phenomena was not there. It was very alien to us. And then whipping and stuff like that started coming in. And for 10 years, we had this military rule that was there. And this is the Haqqani network. They were compared as the moral equivalent of our founding father by President Reagan at that time. And this is in 1985. And then there's a plane crash and Zia-ul Huq dies. So 10 years of Islamization experiment suddenly comes to a halt. And guess what? Benazir Bhutto, coming from Oxford, a young lady, comes in and she sweeps the election. All right, a secular person talking about modernity, progress, a woman leader, she sweeps the election. So yes, we've had this Islamization process, but there's a big part within Pakistan society that is very, very progressive. The last seven elections that we've had, we have these religious leaders who make a lot of noise, but if you see, more than 90% of the votes go to these secular parties. Pakistan, it's called the Islamic Republic of Pakistan. If you see, we have India, we have Iran, and we have Afghanistan on three sides. Both India has as many Muslim population as Pakistan. Afghanistan is about 97% Muslims, Iran close to 97% Muslims. Pakistan has had a very acrimonious relationship with all of these three Muslim-dominating countries. And guess what? The blue color on top is China. And with China, we've had last 60 years as close relationship as one can possibly think about, okay? And it is irony that, you know, we think that Islamic Republic of Pakistan, these ideologues, have had a troubled relationship with all its neighbors except the Chinese. I mean, they are not even people of the book. We as Muslims recognize the people of the book, they're not. So, you know, despite of the ideology, the reality on the ground is quite different. This question that always comes up, why do they hate us? And here I'd like to play a brief video. Can you put on the video, please?
We also have a history of kind of moving in and out of Pakistan. I mean, let's remember here, the people we are fighting today, we funded 20 years ago. And we did it because we were locked in this struggle with the Soviet Union. They invaded Afghanistan, and we did not want to see them control Central Asia. And we went to work. And it was President Reagan, in partnership with the Congress, led by Democrats, who said, you know what, sounds like a pretty good idea. Let's deal with the ISI and the Pakistani military, and let's go recruit these Mujahideen, and let's get some to come from Saudi Arabia and other places, importing their Wahhabi brand of Islam so that we can go beat the Soviet Union. And guess what? They retreated, they lost billions of dollars, and it led to the collapse of the Soviet Union. So there's a very strong argument, which is, wasn't a bad investment to end the Soviet Union, but let's be careful what we sow, because we will harvest. So we then left Pakistan. We said, okay, fine, you deal with the stingers that we've left all over your country. You deal with the mines that are along the border. And by the way, we don't want to have anything to do with you. In fact, we're sanctioning you. So we stopped dealing with the Pakistani military and with ISI, and we now are making up for a lot of lost time.
Okay. So, thank you. So I think a very important thing I want to say is that when the Pew survey that takes place, it asks, please tell me if you have a very favorable, somewhat favorable, somewhat unfavorable, or very unfavorable opinion of the United States. This is the survey that is conducted. Now you tell me, if you're living in Pakistan and if you've gone through this, would you have a favorable impression about the United States? And remember, when we say United States, from the Pakistan context, it is the US government. It is the US military. They don't see US people, right? They don't come here, you guys don't go over there. Their only view is when the army generals or the politicians or the congressmen, they like come over there. So when they say unfavorable, I will be the first one to put a tick. I have a very unfavorable view of the US government. But that does not mean we hate people of the United States, because if you hate, then it connotates some kind of an ideology, that why do they hate us? Because if you start asking why do they hate us, you stop asking questions. If the question was, why are these guys so pissed off with us, right? And then you start asking questions. Maybe there's something. But if you say hate, you shut the door immediately, and there is no dialogue, there is no discourse whatsoever. I'm running late on time. I need to rush it really fast. I'm sorry. Pakistan, the most dangerous nation, it was classified, but also it was the world's bravest nation. We've gone through hell and back. We've had over 70,000 people that have died in these terrorist attacks. We've had floods, we've had earthquakes. $100 billion has been the economic loss post 9/11. And we continue to pay, and yet we are blamed for not doing enough, for being ideologues, for being terrorists, et cetera, et cetera. I will kind of skip that, and we'll not play that. Just on this thing, I just want to say, as Henry Kissinger has once said, to be enemies of America is dangerous, but to be friends of America is fatal. And this is Henry Kissinger. You can look it up. Charter for Compassion. John, just a few minutes. I'll just try and rush this through. Charter for Compassion, Pakistan. I'll just go through this thing. We had launched this about 5 years ago. We have various initiatives, Compassion Community Network, where we bring in, we go into schools of underserved communities. We do arts competition, et cetera, et cetera. I'll just rush this through. You guys will get a feel. This was the Compassionate Karachi campaign. We got 400,000 views. We had done a play for all the schools, Compassionate Karachi. We went to about 400 schools. People signed up their vision of Compassionate Karachi. Thank you. This was a compassionate story. What is your story? And by the way, for that compassionate, we not only went to school, we even went to the central prison to get their view of a compassionate Karachi. This was a book which we launched. Ultimately, we came up with a charter. This was at the Karachi Literary Festival. We launched it over there. We read it out over there, and then we had people signing it up. Then we created this charter. This was the declaration. Salman, some of you might notice, we had he played for us. Then after the charter, we went for a 1 million signature campaign. We went to all the schools. We gave them this charter, Compassionate Karachi Charter, that was based on the original charter. Then this was the 1 million signature campaign. Compassionate School Network. These are the skills on which we work, from teacher training programs. We have modular lesson plans, school activities we do, and it's a whole host of things. I'm sorry, I'm trying to rush through this. Partnership and engagement. This is another project which is called Collaborative Libraries. So we go into these underserved communities in these schools. We took 15 of them. And we took them over and we made libraries over there. Now, these were the libraries. And then we had these 15 underserved schools are being adopted by 15 privileged schools. Okay? And then we had this book collection drive where those kids would bring in books and they filled up these libraries. Then we had reading thing, we had debate club. And so the whole idea was not charity. We don't believe in charity. It's about cross-learning between communities, and it was around activities. We had debates, etc., shows. Then this is cricket. Some of you might know this. We have this compassionate cricket. This has been going on since about 3.5 years. We have in these underserved communities. And again, it's not about making people, these underserved community kids play cricket. Through the coaching, we teach them compassionate skills. Even through those libraries, we teach them compassionate skills. So cricket is like the carrot, and through that we like teach them. So they have these regular tournaments. We are in three major underserved areas. Mumkin, this is the word Mumkin mean to make it possible. And this is a women empowerment project. This was a pilot project which we did. Here again, through teaching them these kind of skills of pattern making, etc., teaching them how to be a good mother, good sister, good housewife, etc., etc. What was different here was that we taught them marketing skills, branding skills, entrepreneur skills, and we did three things. We have created three spaces. One was the training center, one is a retail space, and one is like a community women's center. So whatever they stitch, they can sell within their own community. So hence self-sustainability starts coming in. This is another project which we launched about compassionate footprint. This is about adopting trees. It's not just planting trees. and it's a long-term thing. This is compassion. During month of Ramzan, we do that. This we've been doing since 5 years now, that, you know, during the month of Ramzan, we throw out a challenge where we have children come up with innovative projects for their own communities. What can you do within your own community during the month of Ramzan? And then we have this panel of judges, and then we have this competition. Each one comes up with their own projects, what they did, and then we give them seed money, 75,000 rupees, 50,000 rupees. From this seed money, then we mentor them to go and increase their like activity. And some incredible projects have come up with these kids. They do. This was another project which we did. The USAID had built some schools. They're building the schools. We have taken over this school, and Karen has been very excited about that. This is under a 10-year contract. We have taken these schools, and we'll be running them as compassionate schools in the rural areas of Pakistan. And this was we've recently taken them over. So that's it. I think I just want to conclude. If I'm not, thank you. 1 minute. 1 minute. Sorry. Thank you. I just want to conclude our parameters, what we do. Whatever we do, we have to see at least a 5-year time frame. They have to be sustainable. There has to be meaningful impact. We need to ask what is unique about it. What is unique that we can do differently? How can we scale it down the road? It's about hope and inspiration, not charity and pity. It's about creating successful models for other people to emulate. It's about connecting the dots. It's about advocacy. It's about policy change. And we always stand for something instead of standing for against anything, right? That is key. We do not get into any controversy. We don't pass any judgment on like everything. There is no one grand vision. I don't believe in any grand visions. What I believe is a bold direction, right? And as the Chinese say, to cross the river by feeling the pebble underneath your feet. And that's what we do. We keep on evolving our models. And with that, thank you very much.
Well, guess who's next? Mayor Fischer. I do not think that, yes, thank you. I do not think that I need to give an introduction to the mayor, to this particular group of people. But I do personally want to thank Mayor Fischer for all that he's done to make the charter come alive right here in this town. And for all those of you who live here and are part of this community, we also take heart in your story. I can't tell you how many times I have been to places where we're talking about the charter and how people can get started with compassion, and we use this city as the example. And we now have another example. Thank you very much. All of those were terrific. Very good, very good. So if anyone believes that we can't make this happen, to those who kind of look at you and say, oh, well, you know, that all sounds nice, but I don't know what really could happen. We know that things can happen, and they've happened right here in this town. And so I asked Mayor Fischer to come and give us greetings. And thank you, Mayor, for everything you've done.
Thank you, Joan. And greetings to everybody here. Let me say again, if I could, how grateful I am to the Festival of Faiths for the super soulful role that they play in contributing to the character of our city. And we are blessed by their constancy of purpose. And this being our 21st festival, it's just been a wonderful contribution to the Brown family and Sarah and the whole CIR staff. Thank you guys very, very much. Louisville has gained a lot of attention by our commitment to the value of compassion. It's one of the three values that I talk about every day, along with our other two city values of lifelong learning and health. And compassion here in Louisville is an action word. And we just saw a wonderful example of that through Amin. The Dalai Lama referred to compassion being action today in his letter to our city in the Courier Journal this morning, citing Mahatma Gandhi's emphasis on closeness to each other, combined with a sense of responsibility for the well-being of each and every one of our citizens. We define compassion as respect for each and every one of our citizens so that their human potential is flourishing, thriving, or as Thomas Merton would say, shining like the sun. But cities inevitably face challenges, and my city is no example or no is not immune to those challenges. We will always have room to improve in the areas of educational achievement, economic inclusion, environmental and health advances. And there are those in our city and cities, every city all over the world, who still experience injustice and inequality that can create a vacuum of trust. But I believe our focus on compassion creates a proactive invitation, a platform that encourages dialogue, action, relationship building, and then hopefully from that comes the basis of trust. Importantly, compassion builds something that I call social muscle, and that's building the strength and resiliency to get through difficult times. And you have to be intentional about that. We build our social muscle through initiatives like the annual Give a Day Week of Service. Some of y'all saw videos earlier this week of school children explaining how they were serving others and, more importantly, why they were serving others. We're augmenting this with our Compassionate Schools Project, where our children learn how to develop open minds to learn and open hearts to lift each other up. We have had some examples to exercise this social muscle. We saw such an incident last fall when vandals spray painted anti-Muslim messages on the Louisville Islamic Center. Early the next morning, community and religious leaders, many of whom are here today, showed up to denounce the hate and announce plans for a community cleanup the next day. A cleanup that would have taken us on the stage about half a day to do. Instead, 1,000 people showed up, people of all color, nationalities, religions, and political leanings. And I'd say this response did not happen in a vacuum. We had spent years building interfaith respect, compassion, and social muscle, which allowed this swift, almost reflexive, and natural response. Now, more importantly, I believe this value of compassion is a natural human value. All we're really doing in the city by talking about this is reminding people that compassion is part of their behavioral DNA, along with other natural values like kindness, hospitality, and love. So the call to action begs the question, what do we do? What do you do? Thomas Merton, our native son, at least we claim him as a native son because he spent 27 years in Gethsemane, just up the road, said, quote, you do not need to know precisely what is happening or exactly where it is all going. What you need is to recognize the possibilities and challenges offered by the present moment and to embrace them, and I would add, to act on them with courage, faith, and hope. So I ask you to lead. Use your pulpits at home and in your community to preach and shape opinion. The language of hatred and divisiveness is loud today. If it is not responded to, by default, many people think that must be what everybody is thinking. So ironically, you must be loud with kindness and compassion. You must be noticed. This is not the time to be humble or quiet with compassion. We're clearly in a battle for the soul of our country. We're a country of many different religions and cultures. That's our strength. And the only path forward is to celebrate this journey as imperfect people that we're all on, learning to live and to flourish as one. Now, I'd like to make an announcement. 5 years ago, I announced the formation of Compassionate Louisville at the Festival of Faiths. During the past 5 years, we've made significant progress in this goal of becoming more compassionate, and it's never over. Our week of service has grown to over 175,000 acts of compassion. Our public school district is piloting the Compassionate Schools Project that focuses on things like conflict resolution and mindfulness, social and emotional well-being. We've ended veterans' homelessness in our city, and more than 100 businesses and organizations have committed to and are acting on compassion. So it's my honor to use this Festival of Faith's forum once again as an opportunity to share another step in this journey. It's especially fitting given the presence of the founder of the Charter for Compassion, Karen Armstrong, and the board chair of the Charter, Joan Brown Campbell, to make this announcement in concert with them today. I'm pleased to announce that local compassion leaders, led by Tom Williams, our chair of Compassionate Louisville, are working with the Charter for Compassion International to make Louisville a center for compassionate cities, a center that will help Louisville meet its commitment to becoming more compassionate, but also help other cities on their journey to becoming more compassionate. We plan to work. Go ahead. We plan to work on this in earnest over the summer and to formally launch this endeavor this fall. I believe this is the next step in deepening our community commitment to compassion, and we're delighted to work together with the founders of the Charter for Compassion in taking this step. To Karen and Joan, thank you all for your continued inspiration and persistence. To our team at Compassionate Louisville, many of whom are here today, let us continue this journey together on behalf of all people and certainly on behalf of cities all over the world. Thank you.
Thank you very, very much. I want this group that's here to know that we have now 70 cities around the world, and I do mean around the whole world, that are beginning to announce themselves to be compassionate cities. And the key to it is, you know, of course, that the title of mayor is not just a United States title. It is universal. Cities all over the world have mayors. And believe me, it is the voices of the mayors that come forward and say, we are going to be a compassionate city, and the mayor of this city is going to be behind this effort, and it's not going to be something done in a little closet somewhere. This is going to be done by the city and in its name. So what you have done here, and what you are beginning to talk about and take on, is a place where we can host cities from all over the world as they and their mayors begin to say, this is possible. And what you have done, if we can get this word out, Pakistan, that in this country, I do not think we understand Pakistan at all, not that much, hardly. And most certainly, we don't know the story you told. And so we have to take responsibility, Karen.
I have to say that when I go to Pakistan, with all its problems, with all its dangers, there's often a man with a gun beside us in the car. The resilience and joy and absolute enthusiasm and kindness that I met with on this And the exuberance and resilience of the people are utterly inspiring. It's not surprising to me, but it is an absolute delight that you have done all the wonderful work you've done. That's why, as soon as I got this idea for the charter, I said I want Amin present from the very beginning. And you can see why. And I want to thank you. This is a marvellous day for the Charter because we're going to have a much better apparatus here than we've been able to achieve up till now, to bringing these cities together, helping each city to feel it's connected with the other cities around the world, and gradually create a network of compassion citywide, worldwide, to counter some of the violence and hatred. So thank you, Louisville. Thank you for this.
And I just want to say, we, as usual with these things, we've gotten so much more out of being on this journey than what we've contributed as well. And the response from mayors all over the country has been phenomenal. We've had 40 cities already visit us to benchmark our compassion efforts to see what they can take back to their cities. The U.S. Conference of Mayors is meeting in late June. His Holiness the Dalai Lama is going to come and speak to the United States mayors on how we can use strategies of compassion and kindness in our cities to lift our cities up, so we can use the city as the organizing unit to begin this global revolution that we all need as well. So it's easy to get discouraged, but I'm fundamentally optimistic. We're born and we renew every day, and certainly this journey is a great example of how we can do more together. So we're just delighted to be your all's partners.
Owsley?
It's just going to get better and better. We now get to invite you all into this before signing off. And I think we've got microphones at the ready, so maybe I can help point out any hands that would like, and dig deep to ask some good, sturdy, strong questions for this robust panel, if you've got any inside of you. This is a, do we have a hand right there? Yes.
Thank you for giving me more people, images, for daily life to keep the journey going. Can we keep new communities growing, and places where there's no community to plant the seeds of community, which is sometimes harder. The third thing, final thing, is my question. You are good examples of me to continue the journey of community, of compassionate cities. Could each of the speakers list someone that's giving, that's mentoring them in some way that their name or what they're doing or their action is not to be forgotten? Is that a fair question?
Tough question, but a fair question.
Okay, I suppose the person that I know, he's not exactly been a mentor to me, but an inspiration and a fellow worker at one point, is Archbishop Desmond Tutu, with whom I had the privilege of working when I was on the pompous, as he always said, the pompously named high-level group of the Alliance of Civilizations. We met for a year in various parts of the world, and he was just an ebullient but important presence. And when I asked him, when I got the idea of the charter, the first person I asked for would he be helpful, would he support this, was Desmond. And he came back and said, "How can I deny you anything?" And he, his humor, passion, and persistence, nonviolent persistence, is an example of what charisma can do. What the charisma of one or two people in South Africa, Mandela, Tutu, can do to a community, to a whole people. Because at the end of the apartheid era, things are not all perfect in South Africa, but after all those years of oppression, they could have been so much worse. And it reminds me, I think, Martin Luther King is another person, Gandhi another, of what one person can do. Because sometimes we think, well, you know, what can I do? It's only me, and you don't know. And you may think, well, I'm not a saint like Desmond, but Desmond is human, and I don't think there are any saints. Martin Luther King was not a saint, neither was Gandhi. We're all flawed beings. Every one of us is flawed. And it's important that we acknowledge that, because if we don't acknowledge our own flaws, we'll blame other people. But however, don't think that just because you're an ordinary person with ordinary faults and failings and limitations, you cannot be. Don't think you cannot be a person like these luminaries and change things just by the force of your charisma.
We have a question to my left. Sorry, so I guess there's one ahead. Sorry, up top and then to my left, yes. Please, go ahead.
Thank you. My name's Ellen Valancourt, and I'm from Vancouver. I'm up here on the not standing because I'm afraid of heights. But I wanted a bird's eye view. Thank you so much, first of all, Karen, for coming to Vancouver in 2012, and then the mayor for coming with your entourage to Seattle to see Karen there, because that's where I learned about the Festival of Faiths. And it's my third time back here now. And it's something I would very much like to see in Vancouver once we declare ourselves a compassionate city. My question to you, Amin, is I have the privilege of recently welcoming three young Afghani fellows into my home. And I held a welcome party for them with my neighbors, with community, with scholars and colleagues who I work with. And we were honored to have one of the consul generals of Pakistan come as a guest as well. And one of them would not be present. And the anger that they have towards Pakistan, two of them in the Afghan National Army, even though they're so honorable and such beautiful human beings, they have such anger and resentment. And I'm just wondering, you know, I am trying to be love in action and modeling through my actions and behavior, but I don't know, other than that, what to say or how to address that. I've never been to either country.
Okay, Pakistan, it's been a very rough neighborhood. Afghanistan, if you see, Pakistan hosted 4 million Afghan refugees, and it's been nearly 40 years. We still have 2.5 million Afghan refugees with us in Pakistan. And we had about close to 1 million refugees in Europe, and the entire European Union, the wheels were coming off, right? And we quietly had it, and despite of the Presley amendments, sanctions, etc. So we still host 2.5 million Afghanis. Within Afghanistan, there is a lot of conflict going on. There are a lot of tribes, et cetera, et cetera. And there is a lot of baggage. And anything that happens in Kabul or anything like that, it's at once blamed on Pakistan. That we are the whipping boys for the US government sometimes, for the Afghanis, for everybody. And it, because it's very convenient. Each one has their own sorrows, their own points of views. And this I learned in the Middle East. If you want to understand Israel, you need to look at the not just the Holocaust, but the thousands of years of prosecution of the Jewish community. And if you want to understand the Palestinians, you need to really feel the pain of displacement, taking of land, et cetera, et cetera. And through this, you don't have to, you know, change your position. If you're pro-Israeli or pro-Palestinian, you do not have to, but you need to acknowledge each other's pain, like just like Karen says, right? And then ultimately you come to the conclusion that to be pro-Israeli, you have to be pro-Palestinian first. And similarly, to be pro-Palestinian, you need to be pro-Israelis. You need to have this paradigm shift in our entire psyche. If you do not do that, trust me, we are in a huge trouble as a global community. These nation-state structures, these are outdated, these are industrial age thing, this ain't gonna work. And we'll have the same mindset.
Okay, we have to our left, yes, to my left.
Thank you all so much for being here. I'm right here, hi. So my question is to Amin and Joan and Karen. Amin, you mentioned that you are a capitalist with a socialist heart, and you also mentioned that you believe in standing for something and never against something. And then I would pose that also to Joan and ask, since you were involved in the nonviolent resistance to unjust laws, and Karen, how to go about forming a compassionate world globally, would it not be compassionate for us to resist unjust laws like patenting of life, which is the majority of seeds and all of our food globally? How can we not resist those unjust laws that affect everyone globally and put limits on capitalism, which have been the cause of most of the pollution in the world and what's causing global destruction and climate change and, you know, increasing poverty across the world? So how do you marry those things? Thank you.
Right. Right. Thank you. How do we bring the end to capitalism? You should mention you're the capitalist among us, and I'm passing this on to you in a moment. But it's a matter, I think, of restraint, and that's not a popular word. And it's also capitalism because we're encouraged to buy all this stuff that is poisoning us and go on producing more and more. There has always been, at the heart of modernity, a suicidal impulse, I think. In a sense, you see the suicide bomber acting this out with a whole nuclear standoff, for example, that we live during the Cold War, in which I grew up. The problem was not the environment. The problem was that seemed to be imminent nuclear war, where we lived under the shadow of knowing that we had missiles poised at us and we were ready to shoot them back. And if we shot one, it would be mutual destruction. And I agree with you. Nationalism is utterly dead. It should be. Unfortunately, people are trying to revive it. Nationalism's Achilles heel has been the inability to deal with ethnic minorities, people who don't fit the profile. From the time of the Young Turks, who slaughtered 1 million Armenians to create a Turkic state, to the Holocaust. We have this our attitude to the environment is also self-destructive. There's something, and a sense of denial. We are sitting on this thing. I'm glad I'm so old, because I won't be around to see what's going to happen. But I fear it, and it's denial. Just as we lived in this state of denial during the Cold War, and even though we know the nation state is crumbling, we're living in denial. And somehow, denial goes very, very deep into the psyche. The religions, at their best, three important little words that always have to be added, helped people to look squarely at things. They were often offered absurd panaceas, but also said, look, as the Buddha always said, look at what is before you. And I don't know how you educate people to take off those rose-tinted spectacles, but somehow, I think, I know we should say we shouldn't frighten people into taking them off, but sometimes, I agree that the problem is so acute that sometimes a little fear is something healthy, because we should be afraid. I'm afraid I can't give you a quick recipe. If I could, I would be a world leader and, a messiah. That is the problem. It's not just a question of capitalism, it's a question of denial and the deep self-destructive urge that we have, which is itself a dangerous solution. I have no answer for you, I'm afraid. I'm struggling, I'm hoping that the Holy Spirit or something will descend. But he never has yet. But this is our dilemma. But look, we have to keep looking at it and doing everything we can, each one of us, to make people face it. Saving a few light bulbs and putting out our rubbish every week. We all do it, it's a sort of ritual. But it's a sort of hopeless ritual unless we go a little deeper. That's all I can say. Thank you.
Very quickly, on standing for something versus standing, there's a saying that never argue with a stupid person because he'll bring you down to his level and then beat you with his experience. So, look, we need to change the public discourse, right? Either we start going in a reactive mode or we be proactive and we create our own destinies over here. Because if you get sucked into this negative, all of us have a positive and a negative side. We need to choose proactively what we want to do, and we create our own paths. Otherwise, you get sucked into this negativity and you go into the reactive, and then it's an endless thing. Any of these conflicts, you just take it, it's just blame game going on both sides, and that's how it goes. So we chose to stand for something, and for that, we keep on ignoring. As far as capitalism is concerned, I think the whole system is also evolving. You have social capitalism, you have CSR, etc. The only problem is it's not evolving fast enough for the requirement which is needed. So you have at, let's say, Davos, all these guys talking about not just your shareholders, but your entire stakeholders. It's happening, but it's just not happening fast enough.
Yeah, I will just, go ahead. I just want to say something that's probably off the, not exactly on the subject. But as I listen to that, I think about, I have a granddaughter who was in the Peace Corps for 3 years. And one of the things she said to me was, Grandma, it's about the people. It's not just about what is the kind of government, but it's really about the people, how they relate. That young girl is now in Cuba, and she is studying to be a minister in the Presbyterian Seminary in Cuba. Very few people in this country even know there is a Presbyterian Seminary in Cuba. And that, in fact, their education is a European education. And in that sense, it's probably a much tougher place in which to become a minister, to say nothing of how surprised I was when she decided to do that in the first place. But I think these are deep questions. They are questions that take a lot of time to really think about. They're good questions. But I guess I also watch Katie and think, what a lot of people in this country think about Cuba, and here is a young woman, very gifted, getting an education to be a minister in Cuba. And I think that comes, most times when I say it, it's a complete surprise to people. So I think in part, we have to know what we know, and part of what we're talking about is how do we build relationships with the people in countries around the world and begin to build a world that thinks more kindly of one another.
Well, I'll just make a point, because I'm an entrepreneur that just happens to be mayor. There's nothing wrong with capitalism, it's just how are the profits shared? And what we're living in a time right now where the profits are shared disproportionately to the shareholders. And it wasn't that long ago that the profits were shared with the employees, with the community, with the shareholders, and we've lost balance of that. So
capitalism creates opportunity, but we've got it's a symbol right now of what's happened of the loss of balance that we've seen in many different parts of our society, whether it's the political discourse or the 1% and the inequities that are involved with that. So I wouldn't give up on capitalism at all. It's just we need to have a consciousness returned to our collective. And just one other point, the question was asked about the heroes. I think Karin mentioned this. You don't have to look hard to find a hero. One of the beautiful things about being mayor, and Joan will remember this with her daughter, is that you're invited into everybody's home. And the real heroes are people that are not on the front page of the newspaper. It's the single mom, and it's usually a single mom of color, that is, by hell or high water, her son is gonna succeed. Exerting maximum compassion and love with everything she has to help this young man succeed in life against all odds. If that's not compassion, I don't know what is. And these people are in all of our cities. And so often we're looking for some magic solution that's going to come down and instantly rid ourselves of these problems. The reality is the solutions take place one person at a time. And then that becomes the fundamental question for each and every one of us in this room, is who is that one person that you are affecting? It's easy to come to a conference and leave and say it was great. The question is, what do you do when nobody else is looking? Mm-hmm. What do you do in the grit of the moment, in the trenches? Is there somebody in your city that you're helping lift up? And nobody needs to know about it. Mm-hmm. And I'm convinced, because I see enough of that in our city, that when that becomes a collective movement, it becomes part of your culture, then we know we've got a shot at this. But fundamentally, this is a very intimate, personal question on who our heroes are. So thank you for that question.